How's everybody doing tonight?
Great.
Good.
You know, I was talking with a friend of mine the other day about how God uses us when we may not think that He can. You know, we get around people who are real godly people. We get around people who know a lot about the Bible or have a fantastic relationship with God, and we try to compare ourselves to that, and then we wind up trying to compete with them. And then we wind up messing up. And I remember my dad telling me one time, and I love my dad very, very much. My dad and I have a very unique relationship. And my grandfather died. And I went to the funeral, and Dad had asked me to sing at the funeral. And I said, "Dad, I just feel real strong that I need to sing, Precious Lord, Take My Hand." Now, those of you that know me, you know I'm from Eastern Kentucky and I'm the hillbilly guy, you know? And so Dad's like, "You know, they don't do that kind of music here. You need to do their kind of music their way," and, you know, very cultural issues that I'm dealing with right here. But I felt something inside me that was burning really strong that I needed to do it, and Dad was just adamant that I not do that song. So being the wonderful son that I've always been, some of you just laugh. I think everybody actually can. But being the obedient son that I've tried to be to my father and my mother, I did what he wanted me to, and I didn't sing that song. And when I went to where my grandfather was buried, they put him in the ground. I've just got this thing about watching my family being buried. I want, my closure is when the dirt's done. You may not be that way. You may see that it's morbid. That's okay. I'm talking about me. When I walked around to the front of my grandfather's tombstone, on the front of his tombstone was a hand like this. And inscribed underneath that hand, it said, "Precious Lord, take my hand." Now, I had never seen that. I didn't know it was on that. But I wanted a little bit of vindication. So I called my dad. "Hey, man." No, I'm just playing. I wasn't like that. But in my heart, I was. It wasn't that loud, but it was in my heart, I promise. I called him over and I said, "Hey, Dad, I want to show you something." And when he walked around the front of that tombstone and he saw that, I didn't say a word. I said, "I just want to show you something." He broke down and started crying. And he said, "Son, please forgive me." And he said something that has always stuck with me. He said, "Howie, God can talk to you the same way he can talk to me." And for him to say that to me was like a rite of passage. It did something to me. It changed some things in me. And it allowed me to stand up in a boldness that I had really never had before. And what it was that I could hear God for myself. And I could have my own relationship with God. Guys, that's probably the most, well, it's not the most important thing. It is the most important thing. If you don't ever get anything out of being in this church with us, if you don't ever get anything out of getting online and seeing one of my sermons online or Robert's or Jeff's sermons online, if you don't get anything out of it, get this. Work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. But you must diligently seek Him. You must break this open. You must read this. You must pray to Him to where He can talk to you. Did that make any sense to you at all right there? We hear a lot of other people's voices, don't we? I mean, we let a lot of people talk to us, don't we? We take advice from some of the craziest people. They're always jacked up. They're always messed up. But we listen to them and we take advice from them and we think they got it going on. But every time you look, they're stuck, broke, bent, out of shape. Something's going on. So listen. If you want godly counsel, go to a godly person. Is that all right?
Yes.
That's all I'm saying. Find a godly person. Find somebody that's studying. Robert was talking about this when he started up today. I wanted you to know about the two people in the slides and the reason that I put them there. Anne Frank was part of the Holocaust. If you've never heard her story, you need to look her name up, Anne Frank, and look and see what it says about her and what she's been through. And that statement that she made is a powerful statement coming from a person that had everything taken from them. Her dignity. If you don't believe about that, I'm not going into details about that part of the world and what happened during that era. But it was a very difficult time for several groups of people. Fair enough? The other guy is a fellow by the name of Owen Kierkegaard. If you've never read any of his work, he is a phenomenal theologian. You need to look at the things he says, little quips and quotes like this all the time. And I get these things and I look at these things and they mean a lot to me. So that's laying the foundation about what we believe and how we believe it. I look back across this room tonight and I see Danny and Jackie sitting here. I've known them for 20-something years now, I guess. Danny and I actually worked together with a friend of mine named Alex Tangus. He was one of the original board members, and he is a non-resident board member of this church. Introduced Danny and I, and how many times we rode down the road talking about, of course, everything under the sun, but it would always fall back to biblical things. There's an HBO special about what happened during Katrina. Is that right? Was it Katrina?
No, it was before Katrina.
Which one was it, Andrew?
No, you're talking about the HBO deal?
Yeah.
No, that was just about stress and police.
Okay.
Work.
Look up Danny Kelly and HBO specials. Okay.
War on Streets.
Memphis Police Force.
War on Streets. There you go. I'll get it right here in a minute. But Danny was a police officer in New Orleans with Alex. And the stress and everything that went with all the stuff about being a police officer, Danny was the guy that they actually put on one of those HBO specials and they followed him around. Danny's had a real crazy career. Met a lot of people, and there's some people in this room that have done that too. But I want to thank them for being here. They drove all the way from Kingston Springs tonight, so they get the award for the furthest. So make sure I get that credit card number. So, you know, we want to give you a little something. A deficit. I'm just kidding. I'm just playing. But I'm really glad to see you guys. And I've got to say this with everything in my heart. For me to look back and to see Jonathan Ivey sitting in this room makes my heart jump.
Amen.
Of course, Savannah's prettier than you are, so we got to deal with that. Robert stole my line. But I see another friend of mine sitting back there too that I have a tremendous amount of respect for. And I just thank you for being here. And I thank you because he and my son ate the same kind of dirt, did the same kind of things. Just a real special thing. And his son's with him, Colin, and his friends here tonight. And I'm glad you guys are here. Thank you all for being here. If you're glad to be here, go, yeah.
Yeah.
All right, that's all I'm saying. Let's get after this. I say, no, I'm not going to get into it. Tonight, what we're going to be dealing with is Revelation chapter 14. So if you've got your Bible with you, turn to Revelation chapter 14. I'm going to share some things with you tonight. I'm going to share some details with you tonight. And I'm going to make this precursor before we get started. Understand that this is the way that I see this. This is the way that I understand it. I will give you any, of course, you know, you can ask any question you want while we're here. You know that's the way it works. And so I want you to know that the answers that I'm going to give you is the way that I see it. It's the way I understand it. Doesn't mean it's the way that it is. It doesn't mean it's the way it's always going to be. But if we don't leave room for God, we're messed up from the top to the bottom. Does that make sense? Everybody still with me? So that everybody knows the rules of engagement before we dig in. So let us begin with Revelation chapter 14, verses 1 and 2. The Lamb and the 144,000. Then I looked, and behold, a Lamb standing on Mount Zion, and with him 144,000, having his Father's name written on their foreheads. And I heard a voice from heaven, like the voice of many waters, and like the voice of thunder. And I heard the sound of harpists playing their harps. Verses 3 and 4. They sang as it were a new song before the throne, before the four living creatures and the elders. And no one could learn the song except the 144,000 who were redeemed from the earth. These were the ones who were not defiled with women, for they were virgins. They are the ones who follow the Lamb wherever he goes. These were redeemed from among the men, being first fruits to God and to the Lamb. Verse 5. And in their mouth was found no deceit, for they were without fault before the throne of God. Now let's talk just for a minute about these 144,000. These 144,000 are the ones that we refer to as the 12,000 of the 12 tribes. All right? So it's 12,000 from each of the 12 tribes of Israel. Now there's something that we have to make very clear. There are things in Scripture that are applied. This is going to be one of those things that I'm going to share with you. All right? And that is this. In order for them to be at this point and to make it into heaven, they were not Jews as a worshiping or following Jew. They were Jews by birth. Understand? And they had accepted Christ as the Messiah. They would have had to, this is the implication, in order for them to get into heaven. Because Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man comes unto the Father but by me. So it's not a free pass just because they were born Jews. They would have had to convert it to Christianity. Now, I want you to think about something else, and I'm just going to just throw this out there as food for thought. It talks about them being virgins, and it talked about them not defiling themselves with a woman. Now, it wasn't that they were special in the fact that they could not have been married, and so they had to remain celibate. You've got to remember what it was that was going on and what is going to be going on. Not was, but what is going to be going on in the revelation that John is sharing with us. In the fact that how are they going to be able to get with somebody and spend time with somebody when everything that's been going on in these first 3.5 years is going on? People are just trying to survive as individuals, let alone take on the responsibility of taking care of somebody else. Make a little more sense? Think about it. If I've got to take a wife, then, and this is something that I enjoy doing, I don't want it to sound like it's a drudgery, but almost every Thursday, I have the privilege of taking Sue to her doctor's appointments. And I don't mean that like, oh, I've got to take Sue. But it is a responsibility, right? Y'all follow with me just for a minute. How many of you think that I love Sue? That's my mother-in-law, by the way. I love her like I do my own mother. But when I took my wife, I took her mother, I took her sister, I took her brother, I took their spouses and their children, her aunts, her uncles, her grandparents, her entire lineage, I took it as mine. I took that responsibility on. Are you understanding me now? So if I remained celibate, the only responsibility that I would have, had I not been married, had I not had children, the only responsibility that I would have if I didn't have parents would be what?
Yourself.
Me. So you see the difference in the focus. So this circumstantial position that I'm talking about, the implication here, is due to that fact of just simply being in a place where it was not lending itself for them to go out and say, hey, you got me? They're not walking around saying, hey, girl, what's your name? Give me them digits. They ain't got time for that. Nobody's got time for that, guys. You need to pay attention to that because that's the truth. Go back and pick up those first 13 chapters and look at all the stuff that's happening. But look what's about to happen. Because this right here is where everything really starts to change. Not just the plagues, but now we're looking forward to the 7 bowls that are about to be poured out. That's a whole nother level. Anyway, as we go, we find out God sees them as a first fruit. Why would they be considered a first fruit when others had died before them that accepted Christ? He's looking at them as a first fruit, as the re-established 12 tribes of Israel, and knowing their genealogy and their lineage to be able to claim them under the Messiah, not under the law. Did you get that? These are 12,000 of each of the 12 tribes under the Messiah or the New Testament that have kept themselves pure. They're not defiled. No deceit has come from their mouth. Versus the 12 patriarchs and the 12 elders that we see that sit around the throne of God. The 24 that sits around the throne of God. Everybody still with me? Haven't lost anybody. Any questions about that one so far? Okay. Yes, ma'am.
Do they know who they are?
No, not yet.
Are they believers?
They will be.
But not right now.
That's left to be said.
Gotcha.
Okay? So the question is, do they know who they are? Do those 12 tribes know who they are? They do not know their lineages right now, because some of the things, when all of the, I'm looking for a specific word, when all the wars happened and all of the takeovers of Jerusalem and all of the materials, the artifacts, all that information has been taken, and it's somewhere. We don't know where it is. Okay? Nobody knows where it is. But it will be found. That's the thing. And so what people are going to do, and I'll give you an example of this. Becky and I had a friend that she married a man that was from Middle Eastern descent. He actually wound up being my brother-in-law at one time in my life. Very good friend of ours. He had on his wall all of his bloodline. Now, he would have been under Ishmael, not under Isaac. Everybody got that? Okay. So he had on his wall a big giant tree. And it's a picture. And when I say a big picture, it was probably about 4 foot by 4 foot. It was big. But at the root of that tree, it had Abraham. And then it went all the way up until it found his name on that tree. So their lineage had been tracked. He could trace his ancestry all the way back to Abraham, according to what was literally on that photograph. Whether it was factual, actual, I can't say that. I'm just saying what the picture had on it. Okay? So that is what's going to have to happen in order for each of these 12 tribes to say, I'm from Benjamin, I'm from Judah, I'm from this. You got me? Does that make sense? They have to establish the bloodline. Now, there's so many wrinkles in this sheet when we start dealing with this. Robert's question is, are they here now? Don't know. Don't know when that's going to happen. Don't know when that's going to take place. But we know for certain that 144,000 are the ones that were sealed with a mark by God and hidden in the wilderness. You remember we go back? And we remember the river that comes in when the dragon is chasing the 144,000 in the earlier parts of Revelation. The dragon's chasing, and God causes a river to come in and take them to where they can't be found, and he hides them. Remember that? Okay? This is the same 144,000 that we're talking about again. All right? We still on the same page? I don't want to overwhelm. Questions? All right, let's keep going. Now, let's look at the proclamations of the three angels. Then I saw another angel flying in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach to those who dwell on the earth. What is the everlasting gospel? Anybody got a clue what the gospel is? It's a message. It's part of the foundations of this church. It's Jesus Christ and him crucified. That's the gospel. Our salvation comes through Jesus Christ. Does that make sense? So the everlasting gospel is being preached to every nation, tribe, tongue, and people. Which goes back to part of our conversation. Tracking? Guys, I love this stuff. I mean, it's just so awesome. Saying with a loud voice, fear God and give glory to him. For the hour of his judgment has come. And worship him who made heaven and earth, the sea, and springs of water. Verse 8. And another angel followed, saying, Babylon is fallen. Is fallen that great city, because she has made all the nations drink of the wine of wrath of her fornication. Now remember, this Babylon, this is going to be a spiritual leading. This is going to be a spiritual issue that's going on, right? And so we know that that's going to be part of the beast, and that's part of the one who sets up the power and gives the spiritual authority side and brings that part of the world in to worship and bow down to the beast. Then the third angel followed them, saying with a loud voice, "If anyone worships the beast and his image and receives his mark on his forehead or on his hand," verse 10, "he himself shall also drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out full strength into the cup of his indignation. He shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and the presence of the Lamb. And the smoke of their torment ascends forever and ever. And they have no rest day or night who worship the beast and his image. And whoever receives the mark of his name." Verse 12. "He is the patient of the saints. Here are those who kept the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. Then I heard a voice from heaven saying to me, write, blessed are the dead who die in the Lord from now on. Yes, say the Spirit, that they may rest from their labors and their works follow them. 14, then I looked and behold a white cloud, and on the cloud sat one like the Son of Man, having on his head a golden crown, and in his hand a sharp sickle. And another angel came out of the temple crying with a loud voice to him who sat on the cloud, thrust in your sickle and reap the harvest, and reap, for the time has come for you to reap, for the harvest of the earth is ripe. So he who sat on the cloud thrust in his sickle on the earth, and the earth was reaped." Now this is when we're fixing to get into some things. Let's talk about what these grapes are. Let's talk about what this wrath is. And this is about to come. Talk about who's sitting on this cloud. The one who sits on the cloud with the sharp sickle is as the Son of Man. So when it is, that means it's Christ. That's what is being said there. Okay? So what is about to happen is this thing is just about to wind up. This right here is the preeminent moment that we've been waiting for that precedes the blast of the trumpet, that everything is done. Now we're about to come into seven bowls that are about to be poured out upon mankind in a way that this earth has never seen before. It is going to be something to behold. For the believer, what is so awesome about this, for those that are in Christ that have already been resurrected, that have either gone by way of the rapture or gone by way of the grave, already in the presence of God, they're not going to be here for this moment. If, pay attention to me and follow back with me, if you believe in the pre-tribulation theory, there are three different theories. Pick your own. There's a pre-tribulation, a mid-tribulation, and a post-tribulation. Pre-tribulation means before that it ever starts, the Christians, those who are saved, dead, and here, will be raptured. So none of this will affect them if you believe in the pre-tribulation thought process. The mid-tribulation is in the mid of the tribulation, or the middle of the tribulation, is at the 3.5 years when the idol is set up, boom, then everything takes place, and you leave then. The post-tribulation is at the end of everything, and you believe that you suffer through all that and you go. My personal belief, believe what you want to, I believe in pre-tribulation, based on my understanding of Scripture. That's the way I see it today. You guys know, the more I look at this, sometimes I change my mind on stuff, and I always make sure I leave room for God so that He can do what He needs to do to teach me and to show me. And I encourage you to do that very same thing. Don't lock yourself in a box, and don't even try to lock God in a box. He don't fit. Fair enough?
Fair enough.
All right. So, now, you're about to see something. Watch as we move into verse 17. Any questions on that, by the way, before we get any further?
Actually, I have one question.
Okay.
12 and 13. I know it's going back for a minute, but...
In verses 12 and 13?
Yeah. Is that referring to the ones who don't take the mark that they're going to be blessed?
Yes.
That's the one, that's what they're
referring to. Absolutely. That's the way I believe it, brother.
I know we had a conversation about whether if you don't take the mark, if that gets you in heaven or not, and to me, that's what that's saying to me.
I agree. I agree. Okay, going on. Reaping, any other questions? I don't want to jump past anybody. All right. So verse 17, reaping the grapes of wrath. Anybody ever heard a song that goes, "Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord"? He is trampling out the vintage where the grapes of wrath are stored. That line in that song comes directly from right here in Scripture. That's where it comes from. Verse 17, then another angel came out of the temple, which is in heaven, also having a sharp sickle. And another angel came out of the altar, who had the power over fire. And he cried with a loud cry to him who sat, to him who had the sharp sickle, saying, "Thrust in your sickle and gather the clusters of the vine of the earth, for her grapes are fully ripe." Now, I'm going to stop right here because I want you to know who the grapes are. The grapes are all those that have been leading all these charges, all these wars, all this everything against God. You're going to find that. We're coming up to the Battle of Armageddon, and you're going to start seeing that. But when that reaping in and that thrusting, it's time is what he's saying. It's harvest time. It's time for this thing. Ooh, I felt that one. It's time for this thing to happen. It's time. So what you're seeing is that crescendo as it starts to happen, and it's about to break loose. So here we go. Fully ripe. So that means the time is at hand. So the angel thrust his sickle into the earth and gathered the vine of the earth and threw it into the great winepress of the wrath of God. And the winepress was trampled outside the city, and blood came out of the winepress up to the horses' bridles for 1,600 furlongs. Now, I've got to give you some back information. What's about to happen right here is pretty cool. This is some good stuff. When we start looking at this, what did we just say? We just said that the grapes are actually people. The wine press is the wrath. The wine that comes from that wrath, what you're going to find, what you're going to see, what you're going to feel, is you're going to see that it's literally going to be the blood of those people. Because God's wrath is about to take place. Come on in, sweetheart, get you a seat. It's good to see you. So what we find is this is about to happen. Now, where is all these people going to come from? Now, we've got to understand some things. When it talks about this wine, it's talking about the blood. It talks about it being to the horse's bridle. It talks about it being 1,600 furlongs. I'm going to break all that down for you just in a minute and give you all that information. But let's look at where all these are going to come from so that you get an understanding of this. The Armageddon Coalition, we'll call it. Okay? So you see, Magog is going to be coming out of Russia. Gomer and Tamar are coming out of Turkey and Syria. Persia is Iran. Libya, Ethiopia. All these people are going to converge. You see all the circles? You see all the lines directing? They're all going to be converging on this place that we call the Valley of Armageddon. Okay? Everybody getting this? All these people, this big battle, all this war, all of everything is going to be coming in, and it's going to happen right here. Now, I'm going to break it down, and I'm going to let you see exactly where this is and understand what this is about to happen and what it's really going to look like. Let me give you some math. Let's do the math. How long is a furlong? Right? So what is 1,600 furlongs? We got to understand first how much a furlong is. That is 220 yards. 220 yards equals 660 feet. So we take a mile is 5,280 feet. So 660 feet times 1,600 furlongs equal 1,056,000 feet. That equals 200 miles. What? Did we just say 200 miles? Yeah, we did. Now let's look now how this is going to work. The Valley of Armageddon cast a really big circle, right? You can see, it's actually referred to, if you notice right here, what it says right here, it says the Jezreel Valley. You can find it there as well. So it encompasses all of this area. Now, when you start looking at it topographically, it makes sense. The first thing you're going to say is, hey, look, on a flat ground, how are you going to hold any kind of liquid, right? Because this is going to keep running off. Doesn't that make sense? Until you look at the geography of what we're looking at. And if you look here, look at the rim that goes right through here. That goes through the Jordan Rift, it's called. The Valley of Jezreel sits right here. Look at this. Look at this big old pocket. That's one little view of this so that you're starting to wrap your mind around what we're actually talking about. So we got to ask another question now. Now we found out how much our distance is. It's 200 miles. The Bible is not clear whether it's 200 linear miles, if it's a circle of 200 miles. It just says it encompasses 200 miles or, in biblical terms, 1,600 furlongs. Everybody still with me? Math is still working for you? Good, because it was rough on me today. I'm just going to tell you. I thank God for Travis being there because he helped me big time. Because I was about to lose my mind. So, how high is a horse's bridle? All right? The numbers range between 4 and 6 feet. So let's call it 5 feet for the example. We'll just take it in the middle. Fair enough? So I gave you some pictures so you can understand this as it relates to a man. Horse's bridle, horse's bridle, horse's bridle, horse's bridle. If you look at all of those, it's about the height of an average man, head height of an average man. Now, that wine press that's going to be squeezing that wine, that valley is going to be filled with blood. That's how bad this battle is going to be. This is not going to be any joke, guys. This is, as we use this phrase, of biblical proportion. You got me? Make sense? Let me give you another example so you can grasp what we're talking about. That is the Valley of Armageddon. Look how flat that is. Look how broad that is. Look how far you can see. Now watch this. Here's another shot of it. Did that just get a little bit more perspective for you? Can you imagine how many people are going to have to give their life for that to happen in this area? This is going to be the population of the world coming together and coming against Israel in this final push, this final war. That's what's going to be happening. So let's back up, take a couple more shots of this so we understand. Right? We're looking at 200 miles equals 1,600 furlongs. Just to recap, we see how big a loop that casts in the Valley of Armageddon or the Jezreel Valley. Another topographical issue, we can see the bowl that that creates in a natural sense, which I think is pretty cool. How about that horse's bridle, the height of it? We said between 4 and 6 feet, we went 5 for just an average. Examples of that, black and white pictures, you can blow them up really big and they're not pixelated because they were on film. That's why I use them, just so you know. But they actually kind of look kind of cool. Anyway, valley shot. Are you starting now to wrap your mind around what we're talking about? It's still kind of mind-boggling, isn't it? How many people can fit in this valley? How many people are going to be there? Now, I want you to know this, and I want you to understand what I'm saying to you. It's not going to be literally that God's going to set this big box, this big wine press up, and he's going to start cranking bodies through it. That's not what's going to happen. You got me? He's not going to milk the juice out of everybody and then, okay, give me another. It's not going to be like that. This, the total is going to be because the people combined with their bodily, their life-giving blood. You understand? It's not just a valley of nothing but blood. It's people. You getting this? Are you understanding? Have you ever looked at any of the war footage? Have you ever seen some of the true carnages of war, mass wars, where thousands upon thousands of people, and no way to do anything with them except just to pile them up. Can't do anything with them because you can't deal with how much death there actually is. That's what's going to happen here. Now, the beautiful thing about this, and I want you to make sure that you wrap your mind around this, is that you're not involved in this as a Christian if you believe in the pre-tribulation or the mid-tribulation. If you believe in the post-tribulation, it'll be after this. Are you getting it now? So you get to choose your thought process. You get to choose the direction you want to go with this. I want you to be comfortable in what you know, and I want you to know what you know. Don't take my word for this stuff, guys. Open the book up and read it and know it for you. Understand it for you. Have that relationship where you can trust the voice that you're hearing. That it's not just this little thing inside that says, oh, we need to do this or this or this or this. But when it says stop, that you stop. And you know it's God. Let me ask you this question. How many of you have a conscience? Just asking. How many of you have had, the little cartoons where you have the devil on one side, the angel on the other, and the voices are talking? How many of you had that battle before? Okay, so some of you are telling the truth, some of you just flat out lying. It's okay, I ain't mad at you. Y'all figure it out. I'm just playing. I want you to know something. I want you to know what your conscience is so that you get this. Your conscience is the Holy Spirit. That's God trying to talk to you. That's that voice trying to say, hey, don't do that. That's not a good idea. That's not a good plan. You might want to reconsider your position. And then what do? We listen to the other voice because it feels better. You getting this? Does it make sense? We go against our morals. We go against our values. We go against our learning, our education, what we've learned in our homes. We go against those things because it doesn't suit us for that moment or that time, but it always comes back that if had we listened to that voice, it would not have cost us what it did. I'm going to just say amen by myself. I see Colin nodding his head with a big old smile on his face. Me and him track down the same dirt. Are you getting what I'm saying to you tonight? Now, I've shared this story with you guys several times about Becky waking up. And I'm just going to show you how this works because all parties are present by the grace of God. Becky wakes me up. It's about 3 o'clock in the morning, and she says, pray. I'm like, what? She said, there's something going on. Pray. So I'm like, okay. Well, God, help us, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Bless us. 3 o'clock in the morning, I'm back asleep. She hits me and she says, I said pray. Yes, ma'am. I thought my mama stepped in the room. Y'all don't have redheaded people in your life. I'm just putting it that way.
They don't have any redheaded. Amen.
Started praying. And so we started putting some timelines together when Travis got back. And there was a situation, and correct me if I'm telling the story wrong, but Travis and his team had to go into this place, and they went into this place, and they did what they had to do, and they came out, and then sweepers or whoever those guys are that go in and try to find IEDs ask them, where did you guys go in at? And so Travis said, we went in right here, and this is how we went in. And the guy was like, dude, that place is eat up with IEDs. Is that pretty close? That's yes, like, it was like an impossible thing?
Yes, sir.
Did you hear what he just said? I said, it's like an impossible thing. He said, yes, sir. That's all I'm going to get out of that. I'm just going to tell you something. When we started putting the timeline together, when do you think Becky woke up? When do you think I was praying? When do you think Becky was praying? Who do you think was talking to him? Pay attention to what I just told you. The Bible says that man makes his plans. They had a plan. They had to go. They had to do what they were told. Man makes his plans. But here's the good part. God directs his path. So what happened was that young man that day He went in, he did what he did, and all those men came out that went in that day. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
Are you paying attention to what I'm saying? That conscience thing that we try to give ourselves credit for, you need to know something. In Psalms, David's writing, and he says these words. He said, when I was in my mother's womb, you knit me together. I am fearfully and wonderfully made. You see, God's got a DNA in you. Do you know that every human being on the planet is like 98% identical in DNA? Actually, it's 99.975 or something like that. I think we're separated by 0.25%. And that 0.25% makes up gender, makes up race, color pigmentation, body type, eye color. Separated by 0.25%. So who's responsible for the 99.75? So in the heavenly council, when God said to the Son and the Holy Spirit, let us make man in our image. Y'all ain't hearing what I'm saying.
Amen.
Let us make man in our image. And he created Adam. And he saw it wasn't good for him to be alone. And then he made Eve. Still in the replication of the image of God. Guys, don't you ever for one minute think that God doesn't want to be involved in your life. Don't ever for one minute think that he's not involved in your life. You just get to choose what you do. But I will promise you, if you live long enough, you will understand that all the twists and the turn and the paths and the people and the evidence and the things and the issues and the problems and the blah, 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 blah in life is going to make this beautiful tapestry. And every person in this room represents a thread. You've come in contact with somebody else. You're creating something in their life. They're creating something in your life simply through contact. And everybody here has an effect on everybody else. Here's a big thing, and I shared a little bit about this with you. We look at our problems as being big, right? Jeff, I'm going to use you, and I'm going to use Danny, and I'm going to use you, Sue, and I'm going to use you too, Susan. I know these people don't have a problem with me talking about the health things that they've been through. In the eyes of men, catastrophic. Fair? Is that fair?
Yeah.
Okay. I know for certain Jeff shouldn't be here. Because everybody that's had what he's got, and he knew most of them, they're not around. Am I right, Terry? Are you getting that where I'm going with this? All of these things, we see these problems as being so big. Our problems are so big. Our problems are so big. Our problems are so big. And we reduce our God to a lesser size than our problem. That's why he's not able to help you. Pay attention to what I just said. We make our God smaller than our problem. But it's the other way around. God is bigger than our problem. The reason Sue's still here, the reason Susan is still here, the reason Jeff is here, the reason Danny is here, is because God's not done. Listen, everybody has a purpose. Everybody has a reason. From the smallest child in the room to the oldest person in the room, God has a purpose for you at the stage you are in life now. Did you hear that? God has a purpose for you. Whatever you want to be in life, wherever you want to go in life, God wants you to get there, and God wants you to be that more than you want to go there or be that. How about that? He said he loves you, right? He died for you. He wants you to be successful. And I want you guys, I want you to do me a favor. I want you praying for the issues that we talked about, and there's other issues in the room, and everybody knows what they are. But I want you guys to be praying for Jonathan. Okay? If you want to know who Jonathan is, he's the good-looking guy in the red t-shirt. He'll tell you that himself. I want you to be praying for him because he's got something coming up. He's promoting something. It's a big deal, guys. It's a real big deal. Also, he's going to Japan to fight. I'm not praying for God to let him win because that's not fair. That automatically gives you the edge that the other guy don't have. I pray for God to bless your talents and your abilities. And he takes your training and he takes it to the level that you take it. Fair enough? But in these events and things, I want him to be successful. Why do I want him to be successful? I want you guys to know something about mine and Jonathan's relationship. Mine and Jonathan's relationship is like Paul and Timothy in the Bible. I feel like a spiritual father to Jonathan. We're friends. I think that's fair. I want him to succeed. Am I going to get something out of it? Nope. Not monetary. I'm not getting anything out of it. Why do I want him to succeed? Because that's what he wants. And that's my friend I'm talking about. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Melissa's going to school to study to be a nurse. I want her to get whatever degree she wants to go after. I want that for her. But you know what? God wants it more than she wants it. God wants Jonathan to be more successful than he wants to be successful. Are you getting this tonight? God cares about us and he loves us more than we can grasp. Don't let your problem be bigger than your God. If your problem is bigger than your God, get a new God. Hello. Think about what I just told you. If your God's that big, he is not my God.
Amen.
My God has this entire earth as a footstool. That's the size of my God. And I promise you, you don't have a problem the size of this earth. Amen, all by myself again.
Amen.
Are you getting what I'm saying to you tonight? Let God deal with it. Let God handle it. Give it to him. Trust him. Listen to him. Listen to that still small voice the Bible declares it as. Listen to the voice. Why? Because it leads you and guides you in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. And that's good preaching. Nobody in this room picking on anybody. Except, you know, Granny Green. She's waiting for me to say she's 90 again. Blood counts.
We could always go back to the DNA thing in Eastern Kentucky, too, but we'll leave that
alone. The comment that Jeff just made is my family tree looks like a stick, but that's okay. Alabama, same way, but anyway. This is what friends do, right? I love the fact that we can laugh. He's here to laugh with me.
Amen.
Making sense? Say God's good.
God's good.
Next week, I don't want you to miss being here. We're going to dig into chapter 15. Pop your Bible open, read it. Get it on audio, put it on your phone, whatever you got to do, dig into it. Invite somebody. We got 40, how many in this room?
I think 41.
41 people in this room. Last week we had 30, is that right? My calculation right. We increased by 11 this week. I told you we're going to double the size of this church. Keep asking people. Keep inviting people. Talk to people. Tell them. Because what we're doing here is the right thing. We're laying a foundation that people can build the rest of their life on that they can trust it. It's evidence-based, it's proof-based, because it's the Word of God. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
All right. Don't forget, if you don't have anything going on Wednesday nights, even if you do, talk to Robert and Susan. Robert and Susan, y'all hold your hand up. That's this lovely couple right here. At their home on 6:30. Tamara.
Tree won't be there.
Tree won't be there.
That's the trouble section. Y'all ain't made it out yet. 6:30 Wednesday night at Robert and Susan's house. We're working on our study called Do Over. How many of you want a do over in your life? How many of you mess up and just give me a do over? Let me start over. Let me do a fresh thing. Guys, this has been a good study. Ben Mandrell is the one that's hosting it on the videos. It's really good. It's worth your time. If you can get there, come on. If you can't get there, at least get the book. Look it up online. Go to Lifeway, whatever you want to do. But get the study. Read it. It's good information. It's good material. I want you all to know this much right here. I love you with all my heart. I'm glad you're here. And just look at somebody right quick and point at them and say, I'm glad you're here.
You can't
look at me. I'm glad you're here, also. Just so you know, somewhere by yourself. Y'all bang your heads. Father, I thank you for the day. I thank you for your mercy and your grace. Lord, your many, many countless blessings. Father, I thank you for the knowledge of your word. I thank you for the understanding of your word. I thank you for the way that you open your word to us so that we can learn. Father, give us the grace and the mercy to share this good news, this gospel, with other people that are around us. Help us to continue to grow, Father, and help us to continue to be focused upon you. Help us to listen to your Holy Spirit. Father, I pray for each person that's in this room right now that may have some type of infirmity in their body that may not even know that it's there. But I pray for your healing touch, as it says in Isaiah, that it's by your stripes that we're healed. Lord, that that application be done because it is already finished. Allow us, Father, the faith to believe it. Help us to receive it right now in the precious name of Jesus. Thank you for these people, God. Bless them. Bless them abundantly. Grow their faith and nurture them, Lord, and make their relationship with you as you desire and as they seek. And all these things we ask in your name, Jesus. Amen. Amen. God bless you guys. Have a fantastic week. It's so good to see you.